and welcome to this Design Cuts video tutorial. Today we're going to create a glitch effect here in Photoshop. I'm using an image that I have downloaded from unsplash.com, and I'm going to give you the download link to download that so that you can follow along should you wish to do so. We're going to start here in Photoshop by creating a displacement map so that we can actually destroy the image a little bit. And for this, we need an image that's exactly the same size as the one we're working on. So I'll choose image and then image size and just read off this size here so that I can create a displacement image the exact same size. So let's choose file and then new and go and make that image. So the image is going to be 4888 pixels because that's the width of the original, and then 3227. I'm going to set the background content to black because I need that for the image, and I may as well do it here. I'll click create. Now I'll go to the brush tool and I'm going to choose one of the spatter brushes. Now these are in the legacy brushes collection default brushes, and they're all sorts of spatter brushes here. Just select one of them and then just hover over the document. Use the close square bracket key to enlarge the brush because you need it to be quite big. And you're going to paint with white so you can set the default colors here and make sure that white is the foreground color. Now just hit the document with some white splatters. You can adjust the size of the splatter brush as you work, but you do want a fair bit of white, so you might need to click the brush two or three times in any one position to get enough brightness, enough sort of white. So you want your spatter effect to look pretty much just like this, and it can go straight on the background layer. Next, we're going to distort this, and we're going to do it with a wave filter. So I'll choose filter and then distort and wave. Now the settings for the wave filter, you want to have this sort of effect on your image. So you'll look in this little preview window and work out what you need. I've got number of generators set to 13, but you can just adjust that to suit. So you just see how many you need to get an interesting effect in here. I'm finding that wavelength as a minimum, setting it quite different to the maximum gives you a pretty good effect. So you can just adjust that again. There's no science to this. You're just looking for a sort of distorted effect. With amplitude, I've got that wound up to the highest possible value, and you'll probably want that to be the case because you do want it to sort of wiggle a bit. And what's causing the horizontal wiggle rather than vertical wiggle is that I've got horizontal set to 100 here on scale and vertical to 1. If you set vertical to a value, you'll see that you sort of don't get that nice sweeping sort of spiral effect through the image. I kind of like this spirally wave, and so I've set vertical to 1 so I don't get much vertical movement at all. Setting horizontal to 100 is making sure that all the movement pretty much is in a horizontal direction. So just adjust these settings until you get something kind of nice in this window here, and make sure, of course, that you're using sine so you get this sort of waveform. Once you've got something that you like, just click OK. At this point, we will save this. And we'll do that by choosing File and then Save. And we need to save this as a PSD file, so I'm going to call this Distort. It's saved as a PSD file. I'll click Save. Now we can go back to the motorcyclist image and go ahead and apply our distortion, but we're going to do that in a way that is editable. So we're going to convert this background layer for smart filters. I'll click here to unlock it. In earlier versions of Photoshop, you might need to double click it to do that. And then choose Filter Convert for Smart Filters. That makes the image a smart object, and so now we can apply a filter to it, and we'll choose Filter, Distort, and then Displace. I'm using a fairly small displacement, 10 and 10. I've got Stretch to Fit and Repeat Edge Pixels selected, but since we're trying to destroy the image, you can really set these to whatever you like, except that you probably won't want a lot of movement. So let's just click OK. And now we'll go and get our distortion image and click Open. And now the image is distorted using that distort filter. Now, if you think the settings are too much or too little, you can double click here and then change them. So let's just change this. Well, let's change the vertical to say 5 and click OK. Now you will have to reselect your distort image, so it's sort of editable and sort of not, but you certainly can turn it on and off to see the effect. So now that we've got our displacement, once you're happy with the amount of distortion you have in the image, let's go and work on some color channels, because quite often in these sort of video glitch effects, one of the color channels moves a little bit. To get this effect, we'll take this entire layer and drop it onto the new layer icon. So we've got two copies of it. And the top one, we're going to apply another distortion effect to it. And this time we're going to use Shear. So we'll go and select the layer and choose Filter, Distort, and then Shear. Now, what you see here is going to depend on whether you've been playing with the Shear filter in this instance of using Photoshop, and I have. And so I've already got some distortion in here. Typically, you would see that there would just be a single line down the middle of this sort of grid. But we're going to pull this a little bit, and this is sort of a perfect amount of pull, just a little bit of Shear here, and it's probably actually a little bit too much. So you could just size it down a little bit. You can do pretty much whatever you like in this Shear area. So you could pull everything over to one side slightly or to the other side. You could do it on a slight angle, but you don't want much movement, because you're going to see how much movement this is going to give you in just a minute. But you just want a little bit here. I'll click OK. We can see what movement we've got by just turning this top layer on and off. Right now we've got an opaque top layer, so we're getting sort of either or. We're going to see the original distorted image or this new one that's got an extra Shear on it. But we want this to be applied to just one color channel, and there's a way in Photoshop that you can tell Photoshop to apply this entire effect only to one color channel. And you'll do that by selecting the FX icon and choose Blending Options. Here are the channels, and most typically you will want to apply any effects to all red, blue, and green channels so that it's applied to an entire image. This is one of the times that doesn't suit us. So I'm going to turn off the blue and green channels, and you can now see how much movement that Shear filter gave us, because it's the Shear filter that's responsible for breaking the red and cyan so that we're getting red and cyan showing a little bit separately in the image. And that's because we've got the red channel. The opposite of red is cyan, so that's why we're seeing red and cyan movement. If we choose the green channel, then that's green magenta. Green is the opposite to magenta, so that's why we're seeing those two colors. And if we select just the blue channel, well, not surprisingly, we're seeing blue and yellow because they're opposites. I happen to think that the red cyan movement is the most attractive, but you may prefer one of the others, so just choose whichever suits you and click OK. If at this point you think you did too much in the Shear area, well, it's been applied as a smart filter, so you can double click on Shear and now you could readjust it. So you could pull it back a little bit if you thought it was just too much. And that will give you less movement. So you can choose whatever sort of look you like. I happen to like it as it was a minute ago, so I'm just going to press Ctrl Alt Z on a PC. That would be Command Option Z on a Mac, just to undo the last change. There are a couple of other things we can do to the image, and one of them is to bring back our distortion. So we've already got an image of what our distortion looks like. Well, we could use that on our image. So I'm going to right click the background layer here and take duplicate layer, and I'm going to duplicate this layer into the image I'm working in and click OK. So over here we can see that it's now the topmost layer, and of course it's blocking out everything underneath. But we could select a blend mode for it. And typically you might get the best results from these sort of light and blend modes, or maybe even from the contrasty ones, just depending on the look that you're looking for. So I have screen selected here, but I could run down the other blend modes to see what value I got from them. Overlay here, soft light, hard light. So some of them are going to destroy the image in unpleasant ways, and others are going to be a little more subtle and a little bit more the kind of effect that you might want. So I'm going to choose screen as the blend mode I'm using, but I think it's too much of the image. So I'm going to dial down the opacity to zero and just drag it up. Now I'm using the scrubby slider effect here, which is just dragging on the word opacity to adjust the slider. I find that a little bit easier than using this drop down. So most of Photoshop's words operate as scrubby sliders, so it's worth experimenting with those. I'm going to bring that opacity up to about 40%. We're seeing a little bit of the effect, but not a full effect. we'll finish off the image with some noise. Now, if I just go and apply noise to this image, it's going to be very fine grain noise because the image is very large. If I want chunkier noise or bigger grain noise, then it's a value to me to actually create my noise in a smaller document. So I'm going to choose File New, and I'm going to make a document that is roughly the right size. So I'm just going to call for 1,000 pixels by 600 pixels because that's roughly the dimensions of this image underneath, but it's much, much smaller. It's like a factor of 1/5 of the size. I'll click Create. I'm going to fill this layer with 50% gray. So let's just double click on this here and go for 128, 128, 128. Now, if you can luck it out and select it here, great. If you can't, just type in here 128, 128 in red, green, and blue channels. It's 80, 80, 80 as a hex number. That's 50% or neutral gray. I'll click OK. I'm going to dump it in here just with the paint bucket tool for today. To get our noise, we're going to choose Filter and then Noise, and we'll choose Add Noise. And I'm using quite a large amount of noise here. It's dialed up to over 100%. I'm using Gaussian monochromatic noise. What I want is chunky noise. And so you can just experiment with various settings here to see where you get the best result on your noise. I like this sort of lighter, chunkier noise that I'm getting around 100%. So I'll click OK. Now we'll take this noise layer over into our cycling document, our motorcyclist. So let's right click, choose duplicate layer, send it over there and click OK. And of course, when it arrives, it's really, really small because we designed it to be really, really small. Because if we've got noise in a very small document and then we enlarge this document, then we're going to end up with really big grains of noise. Now, we're not seeing it clearly right now because I haven't clicked the check mark. But this is what we get in terms of noise, big chunky noise. It would be impossible pretty much to get it by applying noise just to a layer in this document. So it always works much better if you create it in a smaller document, bring it over and stretch it, because this is noise. This is supposed to be destructive. And let's go and have a look at our blend modes. So I'm going to head for sort of overlay, soft light blend modes, anything where I can really use the sort of grit and grain that this noise layer is giving me. Now, today I might settle for overlay, but of course I'm going to dial down the opacity. I find it best if you can take it to zero and then just move it up and just stop when you start seeing the amount of noise that you want to see in your image. So there we have our video glitch effect. Now, there's no right or wrong when you're creating video glitch effect. They're just things that you can do. One of the things that you can do is to distort the image with some sort of a displace filter. And we created our own displacement filter here that we could distort the image with. And then we've used a shear filter and we've applied that to a layer that's only been blended here in the red channel. That gives us this red and cyan coloring. Of course, if we went and chose the green channel, then we would get green magenta. If we chose the blue channel, we would be seeing blue yellow. We added the displacement image, the one that we used to distort the image, back into the image, and we blended it with the screen blend mode again to get some reinforcement of the damage that whatever it is that's happened in our video machine has done to this piece of tape. And finally, we added noise so we would get a less high-res look, because video recorders and video tapes weren't high-resolution images. And so we don't want to be looking at a pristine high-res image. We want to look at something that could have conceivably been recorded on old-fashioned video tape. I hope that you've enjoyed learning these Photoshop techniques. Let us know what you think in the comments below. And give us a thumbs up if you enjoyed this tutorial. Until next time, I'm Helen Bradley for Design Cuts.